Hi, everyone. This is Inside the Americas, coming up. High-stakes talks for Joe Biden and Vladimir Putin. With U.S.-Russia relations at an all-time low, we'll look back at Putin's long legacy alongside four U.S. presidents. Then, the first state to put a lockdown in place turns a page on the pandemic. Celebrations in California for what's been dubbed the grand reopening. And a nonstop hum, insects everywhere. It's cicada season again in the U.S., a strange phenomena that happens only once every 17 years. I'm Jeannie Godula. Well, it was a busy week full of diplomacy for Joe Biden. His first foreign trip as president was filled with summits with the G7, NATO, and the European Union. And all that came before he finally sat down with Russia's Vladimir Putin for their first face-to-face talks as leaders. Both men went into the meeting not agreeing on much, except the fact that relations between their two countries are at an all-time low. Our Inside the Americas team took a look back at Putin's legacy alongside four different U.S. presidents.
Young and seemingly modern, Vladimir Putin initially appeared to the U.S. like a man they could do business with. There was flattery and hospitality at George Bush's Texas ranch and a fishing trip in bucolic Maine. But the bonhomie disappeared when the U.S. invaded Iraq and removed a client of Russia, Saddam Hussein. After the Russia-Georgia war further strained ties, the Obama administration attempted a reset in 2009.
We worked hard to get the right Russian word. You think we got it?
You get it wrong.
I got it wrong.
Ominously, reset was mistranslated as overload. That's exactly what happened to the relationship when the conflict in Ukraine broke out in 2014. As with Iraq, Russia perceived the U.S. pursuing a regime change agenda around the world. Ties deteriorated further when the Kremlin was accused of helping Donald Trump in the 2016 presidential election.
Our goal continues to be to send a clear message to Russia or others not to do this to us, because we can do stuff to you.
At the D-Day commemorations, Obama and Putin's glances seemed to say just that. We know what you're doing, and so do we. The Russia file cast a long shadow over the Trump presidency. Trump seemed eager to please Putin at the Helsinki summit in 2018, but the Russian president kept his distance, dropping this vintage line.
Whom should you believe? Whom should you disbelieve? You can't believe anyone.
It's not just the 2016 election issue that caused turmoil. This March, U.S. intelligence agencies claimed Russia tried to undermine Joe Biden in the 2020 election. That accusation might not bother Putin. After all, he's outlasted four U.S. presidents.
At the start of this year, California had some of the worst COVID numbers in the United States. But a hugely successful vaccine campaign there has driven down COVID infection rates, making them now among the lowest in the country. That good news prompted California Governor Gavin Newsom to end most COVID restrictions, including mandatory masking and social distancing, outside of hospitals, schools, and public transport. Yuka Royer has more now on that grand reopening that's brought joy and relief to both residents and businesses.
Just in time for the summer, the Golden State comes back to life. The economy has fully reopened for the first time in 15 months.
Let's live again. Let's enjoy life again. Let's enjoy the freedom of finally seeing faces again in person.
No more social distancing or limited capacity. People can pack indoor restaurants and nightclubs almost like before. Fully vaccinated Californians can go to most places without wearing a face mask, though individual businesses and counties can still require them.
So if you want to work out inside with no mask, that's great. We just ask for to see the card. If you don't want to submit it or are not vaccinated or still want to wear a mask, that's fine. You can wear a mask inside or you can work out without a mask outside.
Disneyland has thrown its doors open not just to Californians, but to all tourists. Other businesses, as well as local officials, are also rolling out the red carpet to visitors to try and get tourism back on track.
We believe that the official reopening of the state will encourage people to travel. We'll be getting not so many international tourists. It'll be more tourists from California.
Some measures will remain in place for mega events, such as a requirement for a negative COVID test result or a vaccination certificate at indoor gatherings of more than 5,000 people. Last year saw the West Coast state go from being a pandemic success story to the US epicenter of infections. It was the first to impose a statewide lockdown in March of 2020. But as businesses reopened 3 months later, the number of cases skyrocketed, forcing the economy to shut down again. Over 63,000 people have died from COVID-19, more than anywhere else in the country. Now it has one of the lowest rates of infection in the United States, below 1%. To mark the reopening, 10 lucky Californians won a $1.5 million jackpot as part of an enormous $116 million lottery organized by the state to entice people to get vaccinated.
Next to Peru, where the winner of one of the country's most intense elections in years has still not been officially revealed. Earlier this week, UN Rights Chief Michelle Bachelet expressed concern over rising tensions linked to the poll. Peru's leftist presidential hopeful, Pedro Castillo, is fighting to defend his narrow lead that his right-wing rival, Keiko Fujimori, who's fighting to avoid an imminent corruption trial, is disputing. This week, Castillo declared himself president-elect via his Twitter account, but Fujimori has asked Peru's election jury, the body that calls the final winner, to annul tens of thousands of ballots, possibly flipping the balance in her favor. And in Argentina this week, pre-trial hearings in the investigation into the death of Diego Maradona got underway outside Buenos Aires. The Argentine soccer legend died last November from heart failure, just weeks after undergoing brain surgery. Maradona's night nurse was the first to be questioned. He's one of seven people targeted in the manslaughter probe. Brian Quinn has the details.
The last person to see Diego Maradona alive. The soccer legend's night nurse arrived at prosecutors' offices Monday for questioning, suspected of failing to monitor Maradona for some 12 hours as he lay dying. His lawyer says he was only following orders.
It was indicated that the patient should not be bothered. He was instructed by his superiors. He used to be part of a WhatsApp group in which there were different health professionals, and they told him about these types of things.
Seven of Maradona's former caregivers are under investigation for manslaughter after a board of medical experts determined that the footballer had received deficient and reckless care following brain surgery for a blood clot in November of 2020. He died just 2 weeks later at a rented home in an exclusive neighborhood of Buenos Aires, sparking a national outpouring of grief for the icon who led Argentina to its second ever World Cup victory in 1986. Maradona's daughters have blamed neurosurgeon Leopoldo Luque for his death. Luque, though, says he did his best and that the star was a depressed and often difficult patient who didn't follow doctors' orders. Though he had struggled with substance abuse, no alcohol or illegal drugs were found during Maradona's autopsy. Once all seven individuals have been questioned, a judge will decide if they should stand trial. If convicted, they face between 8 and 25 years in prison.
And finally, there's been a mass invasion of zombies across the United States, but no Hollywood zombies here. These are cicadas, cricket-like insects that rise up from the soil once every 17 years. They are currently swarming certain parts of the U.S., particularly in Washington, D.C. Nick Rushworth has more.
A cicada landed on the US president's neck as he was en route from the USA to Europe. He swatted it off his collar and it fell to the ground.
Watch out for the cicadas. I just got one. It got me.
The press corps, though, had more significant problems. Their plane was delayed by several hours because of a cicada swarm. The species of cicada is called Brood 10. It's only found in the United States. Each insect grows to about 5 centimeters in length. Despite their appearance, they are inoffensive. They're nicknamed zombie cicadas because they spend 17 years under the soil before emerging all at once over a period of several weeks.
By emerging all at once in the billions, maybe even a trillion, they guarantee that there aren't enough predators out at any one time to eat them all.
The cicadas began emerging last month in 15 states, from Georgia to Washington, D.C., and west to Indiana and Illinois. While they are prolific, that is not the case here at this park on Long Island in New York State, where few emerged. Entomologists were concerned the cicadas might have disappeared entirely due to a number of factors.
If you pour concrete over a surface, that pretty much kills the nymphs. The cutting down of trees in development takes their food source away. Also, the introduction of a lot of predators like sparrows and the starlings, which feed on them voraciously, have reduced the populations. There's a certain critical threshold they have, even though they're so plentiful that if you fall below that threshold, it could doom the species to extinction.
This year's zombie cicadas will bore into the ground to reemerge in 2038. They do not threaten crops, but their sheer number can take people by surprise, leading to car accidents, for example. Some see them as a good lunch, grilled or in sushi.
Oh, I love it.
We'll leave you with that. Thanks so much for watching Inside the Americas. We'll see you again next time for all the news from north to south.